today, BERT reveals the ADAS features and driving aspects of the new MG Aster, and we ride the Urban Explorer from Honda Motorcycles.
Hello and welcome to Overdrive. I am Sonit Dutt. Just last week, we brought you a detailed look at the styling and features of the new compact SUV from MG Motors India. And earlier this week, BERT was at BIC India's Formula One racetrack to evaluate every driving aspect of the Aster. Let's take a look.
Finds all a bit strange, isn't it? Us being at India's premier Formula One racetrack, an SUV in the background. Well, what are we doing at the BIC? But, we're here to drive MG's fifth offering for the Indian market. This is the Aster, a compact SUV. It competes against the likes of the Creta, the Seltos, the Kushaq, the Tigon, which was recently launched. But we're here to drive this. The reason we're here at the BIC is because it's, as you can see, an uncluttered, clean, clear location to drive a car of this sort. And what we're going to be analyzing are a few aspects about this car. I've already talked about the exteriors, the interiors in a walk around video in detail, but today I'm going to talk about just how this car feels like to drive. MG is fairly confident that the Aster has the dynamic ability to make this a fairly interesting drive experience, which is why we are on a racetrack. But it's not just the dynamic abilities of the Aster and the way the suspension has been set up, the way the chassis works, but it's also a host of those ADAS facilities, the advanced driver assistance systems, that bring a difference to this segment. I'm more interested to see how does that work rather than, you know, being on the racetrack like this. Now, the suspension system is largely the same as what you get on the ZS EV. However, the damper ratings, the spring ratings, those are different because the weight bias has changed. You've now got a petrol motor sitting up front, unlike in the ZS EV where you had a battery pack on the floor pan. So, to counter the effects of that weight, the suspension, the dampers, and the spring ratings were altered considerably. It rides, or at least it's supposed to ride, stiffer. Now, I can't tell you how stiff the ride quality is because you're on a smooth surface. This is a racetrack and there really isn't much to judge how the ride quality is. What I'm also trying to assess is just how energetic this engine is. Because keep in mind, you've got small compact engines, they're all petrol. We haven't seen much of MG's petrol lineup and the way it performs because a lot of the focus in the previous cars that MG launched in India, the Hector, the Gloster, was always on diesel. But now for a change, we've got petrols, and what we don't have is the dual clutch transmission that we saw on the Hector as well. This is a standard torque converter. So I'm quite keen to see just how well this combination works. The Aster we are driving today, well, this is the 1.3 litre turbo petrol. Now you get about 140 PS of max power and that comes up at about 5600 RPM. But you also get an enormous 220 Newton meters of torque. That's available, that peaks out at 3600 RPM, which isn't bad. So it has got the power, it has got the torque. It's quick because this engine is also mated to a 6-speed automatic transmission. It isn't a dual clutch transmission, it's a regular torque converter, but it is quite impressive. It is quite quick to change. There's no paddle shift behind the steering wheel, so well, there isn't much you can do about that. But on the whole, the shift quality is impressive, the torque characteristics are impressive, and it is a fairly pleasant car to drive. The automatic, well, I think would definitely be the choice for most people. The other option that you've got is the 1.5 litre petrol. But I think I'd definitely look forward to the 1.3 because it's the peppier engine. I'm going to drop my pace a bit and I'm going to try and figure out how to change the steering input. For that, we need to go into vehicle setting, driver assistance, there's the EPS, the electronic power assist, And well, it is set to dynamic, so I'm going to leave it there. I'm going to go to normal mode and see just how much effort is required in normal mode. We are now in normal mode. Well, there is a bit of lightness, much, much lighter. And with most GPS systems, you know, there really isn't much in terms of feedback that you get. Doesn't matter what car it is. I'm going to shift to urban mode on the steering, which means the steering gets a lot lighter for city conditions. And let's just see how much of a difference does it make on the racetrack. Well, some bit of instability coming because you're pushing this car really, really hard.
The steering is too light for you to accurately judge how much input needs to be provided. So, understeer gets pronounced. However, I will reserve opinion for when we get to drive the Aster on a regular road.
Now, I'm not going to advise you to come to a racetrack in an Aster. But all this indicates it is that when you're driving on a road and you do get a bit of twisty sections, you can have a little bit of fun.
What's really piqued our interest is the level 2 autonomous technology being offered in the Aster. Come right back after this short break to find out more about it. Welcome back here with us on Overdrive. Now, while we do expect MG Motors to offer their cars with the latest technology and features, what is very interesting and a unique selling proposition in this segment is that the car is being offered with level 2 autonomous technology. Here's more on that.
What does level 2 bring to the mix? Well, it brings a mixture of adaptive cruise control, it brings a mixture of lane keep assist and several other features that essentially allow you to stay in the safest place possible. Now, level 2 does not mean you can let go of your steering wheel and assume that the vehicle will drive itself to wherever you want to go. That is not possible, but it still adds a fairly large safety net when you're driving. I'm just going to show you one by one what each of these features does individually. I'm going to start with the lane keep assist. We've engaged lane keep assist. For lane keep assist to work, you need to make sure that you're driving on a road that has got lane markings and that your speed is above 60 kilometers. The range is from 60 to about 120 kilometers. The minute you go up to 60 kilometers an hour, it detects the lane, and now I don't necessarily need to hold the steering wheel. It will automatically inject whatever inputs are required. There is some amount of weight that is nonetheless required on the steering wheel because it senses the amount of torque that your hands are also putting. It does not allow you to take your hands off the steering wheel entirely. About 60. There, it has detected it, and now effectively all the steering inputs will come in from the system itself. Like I said, it's a smart system, but be aware, do not take your hands off the steering wheel. The second most important feature, of course, under ADAS level 2 is of course the adaptive cruise control, and to engage that, all you need to do is just pull the lever towards you. Gives you an indicator on the instrument console that MG Pilot is on, and essentially what this will do is it will control the speed and the braking, maintaining a consistent distance with the vehicle that is ahead of you. Now that distance can be set by just twirling this knob right here on the cruise control stock, or you could also set the speed at which you want cruise control to operate simply by, well, pushing the lever up or pushing the lever down. Let me show you how this works. So I've got a Hector driving ahead of me, and I can constantly hear the brakes coming on to ensure that the distance is being maintained. The third very important feature under ADAS level 2 is of course the speed assist system, and in this essentially what it does is you can select either a speed warning or manual speed selection, wherein you can adjust what speed you want your car to be driven at, or at least you can set saying I want to be warned at 40 kilometers an hour or 60 kilometers an hour or 80 kilometers an hour. And then there is an intelligent system, and what the intelligent system does, it picks up signals from roadside warnings which indicate a speed limit, warnings that are placed on the sides of the road, and it will stop or rather prevent you from exceeding that speed limit. It will stop the car from accelerating harder than say 60 kilometers per hour if that is what is mandated on that particular stretch of road, or 40 kilometers an hour, or as it is indicated. Let me show you how this functions. I've now set it on to intelligent mode. I can see up ahead. I can see up ahead there is a signboard that says 60 kilometers an hour. The MG Aster should pick up that speed warning limit and prevent this car from accelerating harder than 60 kilometers an hour. There is one protocol that you need to make sure you follow, and that is to switch off the adaptive cruise control. Voila! It picked up that speed warning board and is not allowing me to accelerate. I'm trying, my foot is full on the pedal, but it will not allow me to accelerate beyond 60 kilometers an hour. So if it detects that your speed has crossed 60, it will apply the brakes and gradually bring your speed down. So yes, that system works brilliantly. So I'm quite impressed with the way the MG Aster has turned out to be. It feels very European, the way some of these buttons, you know, the way they execute their functions, the way the car drives, the way the car handles. It feels like it was made for the European markets. Of course, there was some tweaking done for Indian conditions as well, but those we haven't been able to assess at this point in time, because I want to see just how good the ride quality is, and that we'll probably only be able to do once you get the car for a road test and we're able to drive it on public roads. But for all other purposes and reasons, the Aster behaves like a reasonably priced European car. I didn't sense too much dive under braking. There is some amount of understeer and a little bit of body roll, but it all feels very, very controlled and solidly planted. Apart from that, the engine, well, it feels energetic. The 1.3 is a good engine. The automatic transmission, the non-dual clutch system, the regular torque converter, well, even that feels competent. It feels very well compatible with that 1.3 turbo petrol. Apart from that, there's that host of safety features that I've talked about as well. Now, those are very interesting and certainly bring a refreshing change to this entire segment. It elevates the segment to a whole new level, and that is essentially what the Aster is trying to achieve. Forget the digital assistant, keep that aside, but just on the safety features, ADAS, the advanced driver assistance systems with level 2 autonomy, well, that brings a whole new game to this market.
We're just days away from the launch of the MG Aster. What we do know is that the car will be available in 5 trim options. Do keep a track of the latest updates on our social media platforms as well as on our website for all the details. We'll take a very quick break here on the show. Coming up on the other side, we'll acquaint you with Honda's latest motorcycle, which they're calling the Urban Explorer.